Welcome guys, we have with us the former captain of Indian women's cricket team, Anjum Chopra. Welcome Anjum Chopra, thank you for joining with us.
Thank you. How have you been? I've been very well, thank you so much.
How's life in the pandemic?
That's not too good. Life, touch wood, is very good, but the pandemic is not too good. So hoping and waiting when it all ends up and we're back to normalcy and as close to normalcy.
So how's lockdown treating you? What have been you've been doing and what's the stuff around you?
It's been actually pretty busy period. Initially, obviously, we were restrained in terms of the number of staff to help around. So those days, trying to help around the household chores and all those areas which I'd never seen before so very closely, managed to look at them. And it's been pretty good getting some time to yourself and completing the pending assignments, pending work that keep getting pushed and delayed. So but at least I got a lot of time for that. So I'm happy and it's nice not to travel to office some days.
Yeah. So Anjum, quickly jumping to your cricketing journey, you've been into multiple sports, basketball, athletics and stuff. How did you particularly venture into cricket only? How did you choose it as your marquee sports?
So I was always into cricket in the sense that I used that is the sport that was played in the backyard. That is the sport that was played most often, even when we were in a group in the colony. So as friends in the living in the same lane or just around, all of us used to get together and play cricket. Other sports as well, but cricket was always around. So that was always the liked sport. And I guess the decision of liking cricket over other sports became much more clearer once there was a decision that I had to take to venture out and go to play basketball or to go and play cricket in the inter-universities. And the dates were clashing, the tournaments were both inter-universities and I was playing both of them for Delhi or for my college. So the decision arose that I should go and play cricket university because cricket was the game that I wanted to pursue even after college, even after university. So I think that's the day that I decided and I realized that even if I love playing cricket, even if I love playing basketball or squash or swimming or whatever game, but it's cricket that I wanted to pursue for a longer career.
Okay, so talking about your international career, the New Zealand tour, New Zealand series, I guess, was your first international series in 1995. Yeah. And you were also awarded the player of the tournament, player of the series in that. As a youngster, how was your mindset back then?
So I wasn't the player of the series in 1995 February series, which is in the New Zealand tour. It was the second tour that I played for India. That was the home series against England women that I played in India. So the mindset was very simple. Ensure that you score enough runs or bowl enough overs so that you get to play the next match and your name is there in the first 11 in the next match. Then the target came about that if you get an opportunity to bat higher in the order, make sure that you score enough runs so that your number doesn't go back down again. Because in my first match for India, what I played, I batted at number 10. So even when I used to play at number 3 or number 4 for Delhi, I batted at number 10 for India. So I didn't think the number 10 was the ideal spot for me to bat.
Yeah.
So the opportunity arose, fortunately, in that same series, earlier on in a test match when I was promoted to open the batting while chasing a very low total of 134, I think, against England, the first test match at Jamshedpur. Second test match at Jamshedpur. First was a tie. So from there on, it was not looking back. So making sure that you score enough runs and go on. So the mindset was very simple. So when you come in as a youngster, your task is just to go there and perform and play to the best of your abilities and learn as much as possible the ropes of international cricket and as much of exposure that you can manage, do that.
So as your career grew, you became that linchpin who mattered the most at crucial junctures. So how did you handle that enormous pressure of always performing, always being up to the ground in that?
There was no pressure at all. Pressure is something that you put on your own self because that's a pressure of expectation that you create yourself. If you're doing well, so there is no pressure at all. You just feel very, very happy about yourself and you just feel responsible because you know that you've put in certain amount of hard work to come to the level that you've been fortunate enough to be playing for India. I mean, there are millions of people who play the sport, and everyone vies for a top slot, but only a few of us get picked to play for India. So I really value that, and I've always felt that it's something which is very nice that happened to me, to be able to don the India colors. So the mindset is very, very simple. Make sure that if you've been given responsibility, do that. And even if you're not in the best of forms, make sure that you score runs. And if you're in the best of forms, make sure that you get the Indian team victory. So the target is very simple. And all the energies are moved towards that side where you can get the success.
So in 2002, you were handed the charge of the side. And as far as I can remember, there were a lot of debutants at that time. How did you instill that self-belief that, you know, we can win anywhere in the world?
Well, that was a good student of management, so I knew how to do that. But look, with seven debutants, you know, you've been a debutant. I had been a debutant just about 7 years ago. So I knew exactly, or maybe 6.5 years ago, when everybody, when I realized that I'll be given the captaincy. So I think it was an easier task. You know, when you have clean slates, when you have very open minds, everyone looking at you because you're the captain and you're a young captain. And all these players, largely all of them were just about my age or a few years elder or younger to me. So we had all been playing, we've all been playing together and knew each other very well. So I had a completely new team, seven debutants and one player making her comeback after 1993. So that was almost 8 years or 8.5 years. So one player making a comeback after 8.5 years and seven debutants, a completely new coach, new manager, new support staff in all respects, and playing a series at home against England. So it was very exciting. I think the excitement level was so very high that there was no room for negativity or any wrong thoughts or ordinary thoughts, because everybody wanted to do well. Everyone wanted to shine bright, make sure that they've been selected and they're given their chance. And when they get their chance, they deliver at that stage. So, you know, I've always felt that if you ensure the players are happy off the ground, they'll be happy on the ground and vice versa. So the job was very much clearly demarcated.
Okay. So as a captain back then, was there any particular player you drew motivation from?
And that particular team that I was captain of?
No, generally, were there any idols that you followed or?
I used to, of course, like a lot of players from Australian team that era. So I used to very keenly look at Mark Waugh, because I thought he was one of those classy batsmen playing for the Australian team with a very, very, very immaculate style of play, a very, very nice manner in which he used to score his runs. Michael Bevan of that era, because he used to make sure that he finishes matches on the winning side for Australia. Excellent runner between the wickets. A lot of these players I've been very, very keenly following through my growing up years. Of course, while I was playing for India, Sachin Tendulkar was a youngster on the Indian team. So his rise, his success, the manner in which he was scoring runs for India as well. Saurav Ganguly, Rahul Dravid, there were immense number of people to be looking up to and trying to emulate and trying to follow to be a very consistent performer. So all these people really helped, being in that era when I was just new to the Indian team, to help me look up to these people and try to follow them and try to be a good player for India.
Who's then the one captain you still follow the most and you admire the most these days in the incumbent era?
Well, again, to be fair, I don't think it's very fair to judge people's captaincy, because you can only judge someone's captaincy when you have either played under them or maybe watched them very, very closely. So we, as a women's team, never used to play those many number of matches where you could really give an example from a women's team. Like Belinda Clark of Australia, I thought was a very, very strong leader. Very good leader, because she used to be a very good bat herself. So she used to lead from the front. But I've never played under her to really know exactly how she thinks and how she plans and how did the Australian team in totality plan for their game. So that is something which is different. And And even in the men's side, so largely you could only see how they were playing, and probably hear the comments that were being spoken or they were being analyzed. So I don't think it's fair to say that any particular person's captaincy is what I followed. But yes, as I said, I followed all these players who were world-class players, world beaters in their own right. So which I really liked and admired.
Okay, so you've also captained in domestic cricket, right? As far as I can remember, for Delhi and for Air India. So this was captaincy something to you that came naturally, or were you primed for that role?
I wasn't trained, but yes, I was given the indication that I will be taking over the mantle someday, and I also myself wanted to take that mantle over someday. As a young kid, obviously the target is to play for the Delhi team and the non-zone team and then go and play for India. But then as you grow in that role, in those respective roles, obviously the target is, it might not be for everyone. For me, it was definitely the target that I must go and captain the state side, zone side, and then the national side. So I wasn't trained as in trained. I don't think many people are trained to go out there and lead their respective teams. But yes, I was always wanting to do that. And to say that whether I was a natural leader or not, I don't know. I think people would know that better who've seen me come through the ranks or seen me grow as an adult, from the different quarters. They'll be able to say that better. That yes, captaincy came naturally to me or didn't come naturally to me. But I really enjoyed the role.
So in 2012 and 13, you were made the technical consultant to the South African cricket team, women's team. Any particular experiences from that stint?
Oh, lots. I really enjoyed that scene. I think Cricket South Africa took a very, very bold step. The administration, the management that time, Mr. Jacques Hall was the president or the chief executive of Cricket South Africa at that time. And of course, now as well, he's back in that role. Mr. Jordan, at that time, making it sure that they're able to get a player from not only their country but from an international land to come and be a part of their team and their setup. So I think that was a very, very brave call, because looking at it, which is in 2012 rather, not even 13, to be a part of an international team who herself has been playing. So whatever they thought, I thought was a very, very important call, and I completely enjoyed it because I was still a player. I had not retired, and I was playing with those players, wearing different colors, of course. But now I was in the same dressing room, wearing the same colors as them, and then I was trying to guide them to do well. So for me, it was an important step also, because it was, I won't say it's a test of my knowledge, but it's a test of how I can share or impart that knowledge or share those experiences with those players who are there, and those good things which I have seen and not those good things which I have seen, how they can be balanced out and shared with those present cricketers to become better individuals and better players.
So cricket has always been a male-dominated sport, predominantly. It's not now, it's transforming now. But when you started, did you face any intricacies of climbing up the charts or something like that? I'm sure you must have.
Yeah, I'm sure I must have. I'm sure I have as well. But again, the focus was such that it was always going to be that. I always knew that I had to get to a position. I knew I had to climb that ladder. So all these factors that even came in, probably why they don't. There are a few instances in my college or in my school or whatever that they came through. But the focus was so very firm and so very straight that maybe I didn't pay much attention or much heed to those comments or those doings, because the idea was, let's do this and move on, because the idea is to go out there and play for India and perform for India.
So, can we see a full-fledged Indian Premier League for women's now? Are you a supporter of that?
It doesn't matter whether I'm a supporter or non-supporter. I'm not the decision maker in any way. So I'll be happy if I get to commentate over there or be a part of the setup in any which way. That's the best I can do, or I think that's the best role I can see for myself. So I'm always keen to working around the cricket setup in whichever capacity. But as I say, I'm not the decision maker for that. But yes, eventually, if women's IPL happens, yeah, I mean, if India can host a women's IPL or any other name, whatever they want to give it, It'll be very nice simply because, look, it's for me, it's not about dependent on what name you give to the tournament that you're organizing for the women players. It's about putting forward an opportunity for more players to go and play more matches, whether it's domestically or having international exposure coming in. Because that's the only way, as a player, I know for sure, and I think it's not rocket science, know that as a player, the more you play, the better player you tend to become. You need to go out there and test yourself as many number of days as possible in a year. And that's the only way you can become a better player. So whichever tournament you're playing, whatever is the name, that doesn't matter. But as long as I, as Anjum Chopra, get to be a part of that tournament, I'm happy.
So young players like Shefali Verma and Smriti Mandhana have risen to prominence in recent past. Who are those few players, of chunk of players, who you see climbing up the charts in future?
Well, at the present moment, these two for sure. I'm sure I will not discount Harmanpreet Kaur because I just feel that, you know, the age is definitely catching up on her, but I still feel that she's not hit her best form yet in international cricket. It was there, but I wouldn't want to discount her that she's over the hill in terms of her performance. So I will put her in one of those players in those categories where probably she's also one of those match winners for India. Another few players, I would say that maybe Deepti Sharma is one such player that I would want to count in and say that she should be a good prospect going forwards. Few young players, I'll say maybe a few medium pacers coming through the ranks in a few state teams. Those are important players I would want to see. And these players should probably start learning from players like not only just Shefali or Smriti, but even from Harman or even how Jemima Rodrigues has come into the international fold. She's still a youngster, but how these players have come in. So try to learn the best from the best.
So we all know you have been a great, great cricketer, a legend of the game. And in the second innings of your life, you are enjoying your commentary stints a lot. Which innings do you think is the most memorable one?
As a commentator?
No, the innings of your life, as a cricketer or as a broadcaster, you enjoy the most.
Well, life is a journey. You're supposed to enjoy that. And if success happens to you, make sure that success becomes a journey as well. So I've been fortunate enough to play for India. I've been blessed that I've been able to captain India. And now I get to watch the match the closest from where the action happens. So I enjoy that stint as well. And I won't say that stint as a player was good or this is better. It's just been different phases of life. That was excellent. This is brilliant. So I'm enjoying both.
True, true. So if you have to give that one message to all those youngsters following the sport or who want to pursue in the sport, what will that be?
Well, the message is absolutely clear. You love the sport, go out there and play the sport. You know,
And
if my
generally
senior
in
is.
every walk of life.
Yeah, I mean, and I say this irrespective, whether it's somebody who wants to play cricket or basketball, it doesn't matter. I think I've always maintained this, that you should always follow your passion. And if you think that you're good in a particular field, make sure that you go out there and do that and do it with all your intent. Because if, and especially in our field, if somebody, if the seniors probably playing 2 decades or 3 decades before I took to the game had thought that, oh, what's in it for me? Why should I play cricket? Probably this generation, what Shefali Verma has seen in international cricket, that wouldn't have happened. So it's always a lot of people who've done that already without being without even looking for rewards or even thinking about them. They've played the sport. I always say that for a youngster, you like to play a sport, make sure you go out there and play it with all your intent and hard work. Rewards will follow. If you're good, the rewards won't stay away from you.
Okay, so we'll have a quick rapid fire session. I'll ask you 5 questions and you have to give a quick reply with a reason for that. So, first question, if given a chance, who's that one bowler from the current Indian team, who you would like to face?
Radha Yadav.
Radha Yadav. And the reason for that?
She's a left-arm spinner. I would like to face her because I like to face left-arm spinners. Neetu David used to be an exceptional spinner, left-arm spin. Probably after Dayana Eralji, a name which came about in Indian cricket as a prominent name has been Neetu David's, and which will rem which will remain very, very prominent as well because it's that kind of skill she had. So that's one name. And after that, I'm not saying that Radha Yadav is in the same shadow as Neetu David. No, she's not. I'm not even comparing that. Completely miles away. But that's one bowler I'd like to face from this present Indian team bowling lineup.
Okay. And the best captain you've played under?
Myself.
Okay. And the greatest left-handed batsman or batswoman according to you?
Well, I've seen a lot of Karen Rolton from Australia. She used to be a left-hander. She's captained Australia as well. I've seen her bat. I think she was prolific. She's been wonderful. Haven't really seen anyone hitting the ball as hard and as far as what Karen Rolton used to hit the ball. Because I've stood in close-in areas, I've stood in covers, mid-wickets, and I've had a fracture that the ball hitting my hand. She used to hit the ball with that kind of power and timing. And she was very prolific as well. Match winner for Australia. So I've seen her bat very, very closely. And I think she's been wonderful as a batter and as an ambassador to the game.
Okay, so if you have to play with one of these cricketers as a part of their team, who will that be? Virat Kohli, MS Dhoni or Sachin Tendulkar?
I'm happy being in that dressing room where these three players are. Please bring in Mr. Rahul Dravid, Saurav Ganguly also, Anil Kumble as well. I'm happy carrying drinks also, even if I'm a part of that dressing room. It's such a illustrious lineup of players. I mean, why do you want to go left? Why do you want to play? You can just sit on the sidelines and watch them because they're such good. But yes, if I get an opportunity to play, to bat, I think I would want to go in with Virat Kohli, open the innings and make sure I'm able to walk out with MS Dhoni there. And I'll walk behind him, no problem at all. Such kind of prolific player that I'm sure if such players, especially like Virat Kohli, in today's generation, I mean, he's such a good example to be there as somebody, as a young, forget youngster, even a present player for them to follow. It'll be brilliant to be on the non-striker end and with Virat Kohli, making sure that I come back for the twos. Each time he hits the ball, it'll be so good.
Okay. The last question. Test cricket or T20 cricket for you?
Both. I think both have their own significance. I haven't played those many number of T20 matches. Yes, I've played, but not those many. Not that I've played those many test matches also, but still quite a few test matches I've played. So I belong to that era where test cricket was still existing for the Indian team. But I think both of them are equally exciting. They both pose their own challenges in a different manner. And they test a player. In their temperament, in their skill, in their strength, in every which way. So both the formats.
Okay, let me put it that way. You have to bat in one of the matches tomorrow, and it's a test match and it's a T20 match. Only one of those matches.
I'll have more time to bat in a test match. I can get my feet moving, start watching the ball better. I think so. Test match will be better because then you can bat the whole day. T20 does not allow you to bat the whole day.
True. So, I think that's it. Thank you for joining with us, Anjum Chopra. It was a pleasure having you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.